looking up right now as you see Roberto Duran, one of the great fighters of the, well, as a matter of fact, I was going to say of the decades past, but I broadcast one of his fights just about 2 months ago, and you hear the crowd reacting to Roberto Duran. And our first fight of the evening is just about set to get underway. Danny Romero. And this is a bantamweight special attraction. But at stake is a 118-pound title shot. We'll take a look at the tail of the tape. And you'll see a few things here. You'll see that Danny Romero is about an inch taller. He's a pound heavier. He's 2 years older. And he has a 3-inch advantage in reach over Rantanichai Vorapin. In November, Romero had a TKO victory over Armand Piedmont. And Vorapin last November got stopped by Jerry Penalosa in the Philippines in a tough fight. Here are the rules of this fight. Will be contested under it. It's New York State rules. A couple of different things in this fight than you'll see in the next two championship fights. 10-point must scoring system. No standing 8 count. The 3-knockdown rule is in effect. The doctor or the referee can stop the fight. Usually it's just the referee can stop the fight, but I've never seen a doctor advise a referee and then the referee not stop the fight. And the fighter cannot be saved by the bell in any round of the fight. So we're set to go. And you see Rantanichai Vorapin. He's a little southpaw from Dakontot in Thailand, which is up in the northern territories of Thailand. Came from a family of 8 brothers, all of them pretty good fighters. And his tribute, coming in with the American flag draped around him, of course, is out of respect for where we are. As I mentioned at the very top, we're only a few blocks away from what was commonly called, in the aftermath of the immediate terrorist attack, Ground Zero. And as out of respect to the brave firemen and police officers, he's wearing an American flag and carrying the flags in, and he certainly will be ingratiated by the American crowd in attendance here for doing such a thing. This kid's an interesting study. He had over 200 amateur fights, and a lot of those Muay Thai fights in Thailand. He won several championships, both as an amateur and a professional. And this is Danny Romero. Now, Danny Romero, you speak about an amateur career. He's been fighting since the age of 5. 127 victories as an amateur fighter. Several times a U.S. national champion. He turned pro in 1992 after losing in the Olympic semifinal trials. And then he peeled off 23 straight victories to lead to his world title shot in 1995, where he beat Francisco Tejeda for the IBF world title, which he held until July of 97, when, if you remember, that tremendous fight against his fellow Albuquerquean fighter, Johnny Tapia, he lost the title. If you wonder how Romero will do against southpaws, he's fought 11 southpaws in his career, and he's knocked them all out. I asked him how long he was training for this fight. This is a very personable kid, as Danny Romero, a very likable kid. He said, Colonel, I've been training 9 months, but he said, in all honesty, I train all the time. He says, I'm a professional fighter. He says, it's all I know how to do and all I want to do, so I stay ready all the time. He said, nobody's ever going to call me a week before a fight and have me say no, because I'm not ready. And by golly, if you're a professional, Buddy McGirt, that's the way to be, isn't it?
Most definitely. You got to stay ready at all times.
You must stay ready at all times. This guy Romero definitely has a will to win. And now let's go to Jimmy Lennon Jr. for the particulars.
Good evening to you, and we welcome you to the world's most famous arena. We are at Madison Square Garden in New York City as we have a big night of action coming your way, and it's all brought to you by Don King Productions in association with Madison Square Garden, TVKO, Bally's Atlantic City, Caesars Atlantic City, and Budweiser, the undisputed king of beers. This bout coming away, ladies and gentlemen, is sanctioned by the New York State Athletic Commission. The officials as appointed timekeeper at the bell tonight, Kathy Paolillo, and our three judges scoring this action from ringside. We have from West Nyack, New York, Julie Letterman. From Long Island, New York, Ron McNair. Also from Long Island, New York, we have Sid Rubenstein. And our referee in charge of this bout, Pete Santiago. All right, fans, here we go with a super bantamweight special attraction scheduled for 10 rounds of boxing. Introducing to you first on my right, fighting out of the blue corner, entering the ring wearing white trunks with gold trim, hailing from Nakhon Sima, Thailand. He weighed in at 121 pounds. His record stands at 39 wins, 5 losses, with 28 big wins coming by way of knockout. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the hard-hitting Ratanachai Vorapin. And his opponent across the ring on my left, fighting out of the red corner, this 10-round attraction. He is wearing black trunks, fighting out of and representing his hometown of Albuquerque, New Mexico. He weighed in at the super bantamweight limit of 122 pounds even. His record stands at 41 wins, 3 losses, 1 draw, with 35 wins coming by way of knockout. Ladies and gentlemen, here is the 2-time world champion known as Kid Dynamite, introducing Danny Romero. And once again, Pete Santiago is our referee in charge. Now to get instructions.
One second. Okay. How you doing, boxers? We're going under New York State Athletic Commission rules. Remember, keep your hands up. Protect yourself at all times. Good luck to both of you. Shake hands.
All right, so we're set to go with our very first fight of the evening. Bob Sheridan here with Buddy McGirt. The principal's in there. Danny Romero decked out in the black and gold. And in the white with gold trunks and all kinds of trim on it, the southpaw Ratanachai Vorapin, 39-5, 28 KOs. He's the older of the Vorapin brothers. Both of them are national heroes in their native Thailand. Both are action fighters, so it should get hot and heavy in a hurry here.
Yeah, most definitely, Colonel.
See right away, Danny Romero. I mentioned to Buddy, you know, I thought he was about 35 years old because he's been around so long, because I knew him as an amateur as well, but he's only 27 years of age. Ratanachai, by the way, is only 25. He lost his last time out. He's always well-conditioned, saw the quickness of the hands. He has no fear of Danny Romero because he probably doesn't know Danny Romero.
Well, Danny's coming out early, setting the tone and getting the respect from his opponent.
Ratanachai, as I mentioned, along with his brother, Ratanapola, national heroes in the country of Thailand because they've been on the world scene a long time, but most of their fights have been in Thailand. His last time out, he drifted over to the Philippines and got defeated by Jerry Penalosa in the Philippines, so he'd like to be able to come to Madison Square Garden and defeat Danny Romero. Danny has a very nice left jab. He's got a real good left hook. He, as you saw right there, he can come with the uppercut. He's got a nice strong right hand. And I've broadcast, Buddy, several of Vorapin's fights. It's difficult to establish a relationship with a fighter when they don't speak, or I don't speak his language, I should say. And but these are two really nice kids, too. We talked about that on a couple of occasions earlier tonight and some of the fighters that we know. But these guys are really consummate professionals in there in the ring.
Well, like we said earlier, they're students of the game. You know, they do the handling business on the inside. And when it's outside the ring, they're gentlemen, and they don't take it personally.
Danny Romero has a tremendous will to win. He throws terrific combinations. You'll see him, even though he's an American citizen, he has that Mexican style of fighting. Being from Albuquerque, you'll notice him do a lot of that Julio Cesar Chavez stuff where he'll come with the left hook up to the body and then come in behind the right elbow of his opponent, dig to the body, real good body shots. He's trained by his dad, Danny Romero Sr., and they're quite a team. Oftentimes, father and son combinations don't work out, but this is one that really has. Danny really, really wants to get another world title. And, of course, so does Ratanachai. see the shots, but look at Danny. Danny has the hands held high, almost like a European fighter at times, and he gobbles up all of that handiwork from Rantanachai on the gloves and the forearms.
Very tight, very good defense. Eventually, he's going to have to start, when he's catching those punches, he's going to have to counter quick to slow his opponent down.
All right, coming up to the closing seconds of the first round, a good round for Danny Romero.
He's in denial, and he simply cannot beat me.
Arsene's going to be ready for me anyhow I come, so I'm coming with full guns blaring. I don't think I'm going to retire after this fight, because I'm going to win.
Y'all know it's only one king. It's not going to only be one king, because if Lennox Lewis said he's retiring if he loses this fight, he will lose this fight.
Man, I am the champ, Lennox. You are not the champ. Believe me, this is a fight that y'all don't want to miss, because Lennox Lewis, this is his last fight.
And don't miss it. Saturday, November 17th, from Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas, Nevada, Haseem Rahman and Lennox Lewis. You know Lewis wants that title back, and Haseem wants to prove it was no fluke the first time around. The World Heavyweight Championship, Haseem Rahman and Lennox Lewis. All right, we're coming up to round number two here in Madison Square Garden in New York City, and the first of three, what should be very exciting fights, and one of them we know is going to be exciting no matter what happens, and that middleweight championship fight between Felix Trinidad and Bernard Hopkins. Right now we've got Danny Romero decked in the solid black trunks with a little bit of gold on them, and in the white trunks, Rantanachai Borapin of Thailand, former world champ in the super flyweight division. This one is being contested at 121, 122 pounds. So this is in the bantamweight division. But he once held the super flyweight championship, which is really what we call junior bantams here, the 115 pound division. So he's coming up a little bit in weight now to fight Romero. Romero, the consummate professional. Rantanachai goes with a sneaky left-hand lead. Don't forget, the left-hand lead for him is his power shot, being a southpaw. Notice that he's jabbing with the right hand, and his power shot is with the left hand. Usually when you have a southpaw and a right-handed fighter, you see the front feet getting tied up. We haven't seen too much of that tonight, because both of them are very quick on their feet. And they're in and out. They're really good boxers, buddy. That's another reason why you don't see, because they're in, they deliver it like just like that. Nice combination. Nothing really landed, but he did what he had to do and then get out of there.
Exactly.
Before Danny could counter it. Working along with Mark Goldberg and myself, we've got Buddy McGirt, former world champ in his own right, and now he's training fighters, and we're thrilled to have your expertise with us, buddy.
Thank you, Colonel.
Minute 20 to go in round number two.
Romero has to start putting more combinations together. He's just looking for that one shot.
You know something, you're right, buddy. He said that too, that he wants to do that, but Rantanachai is so quick in his feet, he's having difficulty doing that. He knows what he wants to do, and as you pointed out, he needs to do it. Being able to execute it against a guy as quick in his feet as this is tough.
Right there, he was right in position, Danny, but he's waiting.
Again, Danny has had great success with southpaws. He's fought 11 of them, and he's knocked them all out. This guy is, you know, I want to call him cagey, and I want to say he's quicker than he appears. I don't really know what that means, but he is very quick. But I have it in my mind. This guy's quicker than he looks like he is, but he does move. He's exceptionally quick on his feet.
He has big calves, right? He has very big legs for, you know, for a small guy.
He does, and that's where he has generated the power of his 28 knockouts and his 39-win career. Another guy that's got great legs shows power is Nassim, Nassim Ahmed, yeah. Guy with great legs. Nassim, I'm getting used to these names. A few years. Round two is in the books. A better round for Borapin. Did you think he won that round?
Yeah, I think Borapin pulled that round out.
I think he did too.
Danny has to establish his jab. Danny's going to his left, but he's going to his left a little bit too far, which is enabling his opponent to have an escape route. He's got to cut him off totally and get his punches off.
Stay patient, huh? Just keep popping him.
See, here Borapin keeps his hands moving because he knows Danny's going to sit there and catch the punches. which looks good to the judges. Same combination. Danny's not countering no shots. He's just standing there. One shot at a time he's countering with. And Vorpin just scores points and steps out.
And with the sole exception of the one body shot, he really didn't hurt Danny, but those are the points that the judges see, because he's aggressive and he's effective, because he's stopping Danny from countering him. So he gets that round in our book. This is round number 3 at Madison Square Garden in New York. Danny Romero in the black trunks, in the white trunks with the gold trim, from Thailand, Rantanachai Vorapin. I'm Bob Sheridan, with me Mark Goldberg and Buddy McGirt right here at ringside with his expert analysis. Third man in the ring, Pete Santiago of New Jersey, refereeing. The judges are Julie Letterman of New York, Ron McNair of New York, and Sid Rubenstein, also of New York. This fight is under the New York rules, where the next two fights will be the unified rules of boxing. The only real difference being is that the 3 knockdown rule is in effect. And immediately Pete Santiago says no, no knockdown. Nice counterpunch left hand that time by Vorapin. Danny made him pay for it a little bit, popping that left hand right on top of him. Danny trying to get position to load up the right hand right now. He's at it with this guy.
See, Danny steps to his left, and he gives his opponent an escape route. He steps to his left a little bit too much. He's not cutting him off totally.
It's hard for the right-handed fighter, unless he takes a crossover step to take, I don't mean cross his legs over, but when he slides off to his right to come back and land the right hand with any power when he slides to his right. But you got to throw that right hand and get yourself a position to throw it again.
You see, what's happening here is that old story, when you fight a southpaw, you got to move to your left. I don't believe that, because what he's doing is, when Danny's moving to his left, Vorpin is able to hit him with both hands. You know, it gives him an angle where he can just hit you with both hands. But if Danny just steps a little bit to his right, out of range of Vorpin, Vorpin has to reach for him. You only can hit him with one hand, which would be the left hand, and you catch him reaching.
That time he was able to land a quick combination, a 1-2 punch combination with the right hand and back with the left, because he did exactly what Buddy was talking about, in that he was more in front of him. He threw his right hand right down the middle, which they say is the way too. That's one of the textbook things they say.
Yes.
Looks like there's a cut from a headbutt by the left eye as the heads came together there. And Rantanachai is very disappointed that this happened to him. And I'm sure Danny's not happy about it either, because this is a fight you want to see and not have it stopped by a bad get. It's in a bad spot too. It's up in the eyelid of the left eye of Vorapin. So now, Buddy, when you cut like that, is a sense of urgency for you if you're the guy that's been cut?
Well, I think that if he has faith in his corner, he will concentrate at his task at hand.
Just get through this round and let his corner work on it. Has 22 seconds to go, so he wants to survive this without Danny nailing him hard. And Danny realizes it, and he's going headhunting. Really hard shots to that eye. He's trying to get at that eye.
When they get close, Danny should bring an uppercut right up the middle.
Closing seconds now. This is the third round of the fight. Certainly a better round for Romero as the bell ends round number 3. Just in case you're wondering, in case of accidental fouls, that certainly would be, you go to the scorecards after half the round, so they've got to get through 5 rounds of this fight before this would be an official fight.
But I think that right now, Vorapin, you know, if he doesn't panic, he can still, you know, take care of business. Here goes the headbutt here. See, accidental headbutt right there. But Vorapin, most fighters would have quit and used that as an excuse. Vorapin, being the champion that he is still in there fighting.
Geez, he just dragged the head right across and just caught him in that eye.
But in the process, Danny can't get too careless either, because this Vorapin's a very good counterpuncher.
Remember again that this fight wouldn't go to the scorecards until after 5 rounds, so we've got to get through 4 and 5 before it's an official fight, and it's a very close fight right now with unofficially Romero winning 1 and 3 and Vorapin perhaps winning the second round. and round three isn't a definitive round for Danny Romero, so some of the judges could have had that Favora pin, which means it's 1 point the other way. Nice combination of punches by Rantanachai, and here is what, buddy, I think you were talking about in that first round where he's waiting a little bit too much, letting this guy come in on him.
Yes.
Danny tries to pick it up. He double jabs, but he's short two times. They got to throw the right hand behind that.
Danny can't go straight back either. He's going straight back. Vorpin is counter with that straight left hand.
Tries to come to his right. He's got the idea to try and get position. Now he slides back to his left. And as he did that, that's one of the few times we've seen him. He tripped over the outstretched front leg of Vorpin. Vorpin back pinned in his corner. Now Danny needs to throw some right hands in here. Instead, he lets him off the hook. Faints a little bit, bounces straight back again. And you see what happened? Hit right on the button with the left. Didn't hurt him, but just what Buddy said. He makes a mistake of bouncing straight back, and he can hit him with the left hand. And remember, the left hand for the southpaw is his power hand. Well, even though it's not a powerful shot, it's a point that the judges are looking at, and Vorpin wants to continue to do that. Every time Danny comes straight back, he'll try to throw that left hand. Danny up on his toes now, bouncing to his left. There he is, straight in front of him again. Comes in. Says Vorpin's a slick little boxer, too. I mean, he's bobbing, moving, slipping that head around. He's a slick little fighter. And as tough as nails.
But Danny's being very predictable. He's doing the same thing. He has to mix up his attacks on him. He's got to feint Vorpin, being he's a counterpuncher, feint him into position. But he's doing the same thing, and Vorpin's starting to figure that out.
Boy, when that those heads came together in the third round and it cut the eye, it put a whale of a knot on the forehead of Danny Romero. And that time has been called by the referee. And he said, hey, guys, watch the heads. Don't mess up a good fight by having to end this thing soon with another headbutt. Boy, he just missed hitting Romero right on the butt.
He's walking straight in.
It becomes very apparent what Buddy is trying to point out to all of us is that as he comes straight in and as he goes straight back, he's wide open for shots, and Rantanachai realizes it.
And Rantanachai's still in this room.
Closing seconds now, the fourth round, which was another good Vorpin round. All right, we got to see if Danny's going to change his fight plan. As Vorpin is doing all right now.
I must say that he's one of the best boxers I've seen from overseas. Vorpin, he's very smart, very relaxed.
Okay? Try to time that right hand.
Unofficially, in my scorecard, I have Romero winning 1 and 3, a close third round, and Vorpin winning 2 and 4. So it's dead even after 4 if the judges see it the same way. But the third round was so close, it could be 1 point the other, you know, one way or the other. And a round that I gave to Romero, it could be in favor of Vorpin. We're going to the fifth round, and this is an important round with the cut eye.
Yeah, but he's coming lower, man.
A note here that as they looked at that, Vorpin was never hit in the eye in that entire round by Romero, and after he had hit him with the headbutt, even though it was accidentally, really went headhunting for that eye, and Danny kind of got away from that. So let's see what Danny does in round number 5. Again, this is an important round because after this, no matter what happens, it'll go to the scorecards, but they've got to get through this round before it's an official fight.
Danny's right eye is closing too.
And Danny's getting whacked inside. Look at this guy work to the body. Danny's got his hands full with Vorpin, let me tell you. And again, every time he's right in front of him is when he's getting nailed, buddy. Look at this guy throwing shots. There's that straight left hand down the middle. Danny misses with a wild right uppercut. He's got the blood coming down from that eye, the head right in front of him below the chin. He's banging the body of Vorpin. And finally, referee Pete Santiago separates the two.
Vorpin is still in the rounds, didn't say he can't see.
Boy, he's really working hard, buddy, isn't he?
Yes. See, Danny's going one punch at a time. He's catching, he's not countering Danny.
There it is. There's a perfect example right there. He throws the right uppercut, then he covers himself up. Meanwhile, Warpin got off about four or five shots in a row. Look at that. Nice combination again. Warpin plants his head in the face of Romero, loads up the left hook. He's got blood trickling from the nose down of Danny Romero.
Let's go, baby. Take pop.
Pete Santiago says, come on, keep it going, guys. Warpin is really making this thing tough on Romero right now. He's having things his way.
He's breaking Danny's rhythm.
Danny really waited that time. He exposed himself when he walked in. He just walked straight in, and he walked right into an uppercut. And Warpin doesn't stop throwing.
Warpin's very smart. I got to give him credit. He's very smart. He's doing a very good job.
Now Danny is cut, and a bad cut in his eyelid. And Danny's complaining there was a headbutt. But he's got a real bad cut in a real bad spot. It's right almost on top of the lid, right close to the eyelash.
I think that was some of that left uppercut.
Might have been some of the left uppercut, or the heads coming together again because Vorpin had his head, you know, right in his face. We'll know when we see the replay, but this fight is getting really, really interesting. And remember, it will go to the scorecards after five rounds if Romero can't continue. And Vorpin's beating him up right now. That cut's really bothering Romero, and it's in a real difficult spot. Meanwhile, the corner of Vorpin has done an excellent job trying to keep that cut closed.
Yes.
Danny's really kind of furious right now. There is a sense, I asked you, when Vorpin get cut, if there's a sense of urgency when a guy gets cut. Danny's showing a sense of urgency to me, isn't he?
Yeah, he's showing he's desperate. Vorpin's keeping cool. He's just handling the task at hand. He's doing the right thing.
All right, there's the bell ending the fifth round, so it's an official fight. That's another Vorpin round.
Not watching the head at all. Shit, look at that. That's the head.
Look at that.
You gotta start watching your
I think that was caught from the uppercut. I don't know, I could be wrong, but I think that left uppercut came right up the middle.
Is it? Boy, look at that, right in the eyelid.
I wonder what the referee's gonna call.
I don't know, but is there a doctor in there looking at that too? That's as bad a cut as you could have, and it is as bad a spot as it could be. They might give him one more round, but that's a bad cut,
yeah,
folks.
You're the champion. You're the champion,
Good.
I think that left uppercut came up the middle and ripped it.
Boy, that's a big gash in the wrong spot. It's like the doctor is going to say, okay. All right, here we go. Round number six, and what has been a very, very difficult fight for Danny Romero so far.
Time in.
And here we go.
Danny's blowing his nose, which is a very bad thing because both his eyes swollen. He shouldn't be blowing his nose.
Don't forget, Vorpin was cut in the right eyelid. Actually, the left eyelid back in the third round, and his corner's done a nice job, but the cut is nowhere near as serious as the cut to Danny Romero is. I don't know if Danny can get through another couple of rounds with that eye like that. I'd be very surprised. Vorpin cracks him one more time or hits him with that uppercut.
In a fight like this, Conor, this is where you got to have a plan B. You got to have something different now because you see that left hand again, open that cut up.
Yeah, I mean, it's just streaming down the left side of his face. And not only is it a bad cut, but it's annoying him, and it's distracting him, and Vorpin's taking advantage of it. Fight's a little sloppy right now, but both guys have cut very bad. Buddy, we ever cut yourself really bad like this?
Not really, Colonel. It was on the outside of my eye.
Uh-huh.
You know, and if they didn't, you know, I just tell them, don't tell me about it. Just hand me, I tell them to come and handle your business. I had a great cut man in Mr. Howie Alpert, so I never really worried.
There's a straight right hand while we were chatting there that got right through by Vorpin right on top of the left eye of Danny Romero.
Vorpin's keeping his cool. When he got cut, he didn't panic. Romero showed a sense of panic. Now he's getting hit by unnecessary shot.
This is the sixth time I've done a Vorpin fight. Actually, a Rantana Chai Vorpin fight. I've done more because I've done the brothers' fights as well. This is the best I've ever seen him look against a world-class fighter like Danny Romero. I mean, he really looks good out here.
You see, Romero's panicking, and he's making the fight much easier.
Now, referee Pete Santiago is going to have the doc take another look, and this may be it for Danny Romero.
You can see right
he says, let him go a little more. You know, he said in between rounds, we'll give it another round. And obviously, Pete sees something that we can't see right here, but it's obvious that it's a very bad cut up there. And Danny's got to fight through it, and he's got to know that there's a real sense of urgency. Now, he's got to knock this guy out if he's going to win the fight. Because Vorpin not only has him cut, but he's winning the round.
Yes, he's winning the fight right now, Vorpin.
As Vorpin is ticketing those punches for that left eye, and he's landing. He's landing the right hand, which is his jab, and he hooks with his right because he's a southpaw. And he's trying to get one more power shot on top of it. Because Vorpin has been over here many times and has had difficulty in beating these American fighters. And he'd like to go back to Thailand with a victory. Danny, no power, those shots at all in there.
He's showing a sign of desperation. And I think he's never been in this position before. And he really is crumbling under the pressure right now. Vorpin's remaining calm and just handling his business.
Vorpin has fought beyond as the bell ends at round six. And Vorpin has got pretty seriously himself. His left eye, as you saw. And here's Danny kind of staggering around. He's really, really distracted by that eye. I'd be really surprised if he can go much further.
No, no, not yet. It's getting there, not yet, though. Want to come up?
Is that a headbutt? You call that a headbutt?
That was caused by an
let's take a look at it. Look up.
I can see. Look
up. Just look up.
I can see that.
All right, second job. They're closing themselves.
All right, the doctor and the inspector from the New York State Athletic Commission are going to give him a little bit longer. And is Rantanachai Vorpin in the white trunks goes headhunting immediately. They've got the cut closed up nicely of Vorpin. And Danny's stays all right until there's something hit right on top of it, but his is much more, as we pointed out on several occasions here, much more of a serious cut. This is round seven. It's scheduled for 10. Vorpin cut in the third round. Danny Romero cut in the fifth round. We're in round seven. So it's an official fight. Now Danny doing what he has to do. Forget about the eye. If you get hit in the eye, you get hit. I gotta start winning some rounds here. I gotta put this guy down. And while he didn't get too many boxing instructions, he's veteran enough to know that he's gotta pick up the pace. As a kid that's got, you know, almost 50 professional fights.
He's gotta let his hands flow, Connor, you're right.
Don't forget, coming up after this, Ricardo Lopez and Zolani Petillo for the IBF Light Flyweight Championship. That's 108-pound division. And then, of course, the big one, the unification of the middleweight championship, Felix Tito Trinidad and Bernard Hopkins, the real reason why we're all here.
Vorpin's having fun in there. He's relaxed and he's having a good time.
Danny sliding back to his left, plants his feet, gets through. Kind of a hooking right hand. He's not throwing it with a lot of power. He's not turning his hips. He's not getting his shoulder into it.
He's got to set Vorpin up for it. He's not setting him up. He's just coming in. And Vorpin's too smart for that.
And Vorpin doing things now to take the heart away from Danny, putting the fist in his face as he pushes him away. Yeah. And he's got that pleasant smile on his face, but he's a cute little fighter.
He's having a good time in there.
You hear the crowd in attendance cheering, and what's happened is a whole crowd of the New York city fire department has come in, and they're actually getting a standing ovation, which is kind of heartwarming, believe me, considering what they've been through and the loss of lives and the great job the fire department tried to do, and many of them gave their lives trying to help civilians here in the city of New York and the Twin Tower tragedy that happened. And we've got a dandy of a fight going on here. Two very game, very tough fighters, both with cuts in their eye, giving it all they have. And now the chant USA starts. And the garden is pretty jammed. I can't see a lot of empty seats. The ticket director, Jean Berry, told me that she expected to be pretty close to a sellout, if not a sellout, as the bell ends the seventh round. And I thought that was a better... This is some of the firemen there.
They've done a great job. They're in the New York City Police Department. I can honestly say they did a great job.
Seventh round, another pretty good round as we're acknowledging the firemen coming in here. Another pretty good round for Voropin, who's just in a... You take a look at Ricardo Lopez. He'll be fighting Zolani Patello next. This kid here, if you don't know him and haven't seen him, he may be slightly over the top at age 34, but my way of thinking, the very best technical fighter in the world, in my opinion, just a tremendous, tremendous fighter. He does things so well, so slick, so sleek, you don't even realize what he's doing as he's beating guys up. Meanwhile, Voropin has built up some points to the point on my scorecard where Romero needs either a knockout or needs to win every one of these last three rounds. This is a 10-round fight. Bad cuts in the fight. Voropin's corner done an excellent job with a cut that he got way back in the third round. And then Danny Romero, either we really couldn't tell by a replay whether it was the uppercut that we thought it might be or whether the heads came together. And now Danny is hitting the eye again, or he has, it looks like, a lot of Vaseline in his eye. He's really distracted by his left eye anyway. But it's been a much bigger problem, the left eye, which he's going to be having difficulty seeing out of. And Voropin taking advantage of that. He's been headhunting ever since.
Every now and then he puts a little left hand to Danny's body to keep him honest.
Danny trying to work upstairs, but... You know, I'm surprised Danny just hasn't, like, really opened up and just let throw caution to the wind and said, just let me go all out, like, almost like an amateur trying to finish this guy off to put the pressure on him. He's trying to box him, and it's not working because Voropin is very, very quick on his feet, and he's able to throw combinations, and he's been able to land, and he's got Danny off the pace. There's another great straight left hand right down the middle.
Danny fell right into his groove. From Ryan to his opponent's groove.
And you know, buddy, they always talk about the way to fight a southpaw is to throw the straight right hand down the middle. Well, it's true for a southpaw, too, to throw the straight left hand down the middle, as he just did there again, and bounce the head back at Danny Romero. There's the shot that Danny would love to set him up when he's bent over like that and fully extended with his jaw to drop that hammer-like right hand on him and try and drop Rantanachai. Well, I will say one thing for Romero's corner. They've done a sensational job since the fifth round of keeping this kid in the fight.
They did a great job.
Because I didn't think that, and Danny Romero Sr. actually works on the cuts. He's got Henry Chavez and Paul Garul at work in the corner as well. His cousins, or actually they're his uncles, Danny's uncles. But it's his dad that handles the cuts. And he's done a terrific job with Danny. There's blood trickling down, to be sure, but he's kept him in the fight. And really, I thought when I saw that cut that that was going to be it. Seen a lot of cuts, buddy, and I'm not quick to say end the fight because of a cut.
Well, I suppose if you got faith in your cornerman, you go out there and you handle the task at hand.
Straight right hand gets through now, but Voropin counters with a nice left hook and follows it right up by right hand. Voropin doesn't know anything about throwing one punch at a time. And Danny's been caught many times throwing the one punch.
He's standing there and he's waiting for a receipt. He's got to get his punches off and move his upper body. There's no upper body movement from Danny.
All right, the bell ends the eighth round, and Voropin's just outboxing him, in my opinion, every round now. get it 78-74 with two rounds to go. If the judges have it close to the way I have it, it would take a knockout. The doctor, and again looking at that eye of Danny Romero. That's the eye of Voropin right there. You can see the slit, which is not in a really good location either. That's a bad location, but it's not as bad a cut in general as the one that Danny has.
The counter, you see how
tries to get that right hand on top of him. Voropin, I'm afraid, I hate to say this, has taken a lot of the heart away from Danny too with this. Because Danny just hasn't really, or maybe it's the style. I don't know, buddy. What do you think?
I think that what happened is that Danny had one plan. He didn't have a plan B, C, or D. He had one plan. When that plan didn't work, he didn't know how to resort to something different.
This is round number 9. It's scheduled for 10. We're in Madison Square Garden, New York City. Danny Romero, former 115-pound IBF world champ, against Rantanachai Voropin, former super flyweight champion of the world from Thailand. And Voropin has been outboxing Danny Romero for the last 4 or 5 rounds. Now the crowd begins to chant Tito, Tito. They can't wait. As good a fight and as hard and difficult fight as this is, as the left hand gets through by Voropin, the crowd, you just sense an anticipation.
Yeah.
They want to see Felix Trinidad and Bernard Hopkins. That's what they're here for. And no matter how much I tell you how great a fighter Ricardo Lopez is in the next fighter, how hard these two guys are working. Nice left hand in there by Voropin. How hard they're working, it's not enough for them. They came to see one fight tonight.
But this turned out to be a good fight. Very smart boxing by Voropin.
Very tough fight for Danny and a terrific fight for Voropin. His last 9 fights, Danny Romero's 8-0-1. He's been on a tear. Won all 5 of his fights last year. All 4 in 1999. 98, he won 3. And that takes you back to 97 when he had his last loss, which was against Johnny Tapia in July of 1997. He's reeled off all kinds of victories. He did have that one loss against the kid Bungu in Atlantic City back in 98. When he lost the battle for the IBF in the 12-round affair, and that one was a tough fight for him, too. That's the only other loss he's had going since the Tapia fight, I should say. But he has been on a tear as of late, and he's not having it his way tonight. This is a tough fight for him. Danny's as tough as nails, though.
Oh, yes, definitely.
He is. He's hanging in there. He's doing everything he can possibly be doing. No matter what he tries, buddy, it's just not enough tonight with this kid. Which is to the credit of Rantanachai Voropin. Closing seconds now, the 9th round. I give a lot of credit to both fighters because both of them were hurt in this fight. Hurt from cuts. Voropin back in the 3rd round. Danny Romero. And there's Bernard Hopkins, who has arrived at the building just about an hour ago. Or about 2 minutes ago, I should say. I just checked my watch there. Yeah, 2 minutes ago. 9:50 on the East Coast. All business on his face. He says he's going to knock out Trinidad and he's going to punish Trinidad. So he actually came in 1 solid hour after Trinidad.
Well, now here we go with round number 10, the final round of this bout, round 10.
All right, we're coming up to the 10th and final round in a fight now that I believe Danny Romero in the black trunks must score a knockout to if he's going to win this one. Rantanachai Vorapin has had things his way from the fourth round on. Danny had a bad cut in his left eye lid back in the fifth round, and since then, Vorapin has just dictated the pace of the fight. He's thrown better combinations, landed more shots, avoided more shots. And Danny, I will say, as the heart of a great champion that he was, and hopefully someday will be again, but I don't think this night is going to be his night.
But right now, he's showing a bit of urgency right now. He's coming out, and he's showing that he's desperate, but he has to let his hands fly. It's the last round. And
instead, he walks right into a left hand, a straight left hand. Remember, that's the power shot to the southpaw. And he's very puffy below the right eye as well, although the cut's in the left eye. Oh, big, big looping left hand. Power shot. Danny able to stay on his feet all right, but he felt it. Bleeding from the nose, bleeding from the left eye, right eye almost shut. Vorapin just beating him up right now.
He's taking him to school right now.
I mentioned I've done several of Vorapin's fights, and this is the best I've seen him look against a real good fighter. Go ahead, buddy.
No, I'm sorry, Colonel. He rose to the occasion. I apologize.
He really has. He's fighting a terrific fight. But Danny is no slouch himself. He's got that smile on his face now. He knows that he's in great command right here. He'd be smart now to just tap this guy. It's not his nature, though. It's not the nature of a fighter to do that. They all want to finish strong, but he's got this fight won. And there's no sense of getting caught by a wild shot by Romero right now. Just a little over a minute to go, and he's got himself a victory, which will lead to a shot at the probably 118-pound title shot for him. This fight was originally scheduled for as far back as June. Postponed a couple of times while Danny got his contract squared away. He had some contract problems. He got that all squared away. And Vorapin has taken him to school in the later rounds of this fight, especially since the cut occurred in the fifth round. Inside of 30 seconds to go now in the fight, and Vorapin continues to beat him to the punch. And again, I reiterate, a terrific job by both corners to keep these guys in the fight and let them do what they do. Vorapin just hangs on. He's got that look of confidence in his face. He knows boxing things are his way.
We need more warriors like these two guys in boxing.
A little sloppy at this stage right now, but there's the bell ending a very, very tough, hard-fought battle for both guys. But that, my friends, should be a Vorapin, a landslide score. I've got it 98-92. Remember, the judges are Julie Letterman, Ron McNair, and Sid Rubenstein, all from New York. They'll do the official scoring, and we'll have it for you as soon as Jimmy Lennon has it. Here's the end of the fight, buddy.
Very good boxing by Vorapin. He knows he has the fight won. Good straight left hand right down the pipe. Danny Romero's walking straight in with no regard for Vorapin's punching power.
And that's one thing, buddy, that you said throughout the course of the fight, that he was positioning himself wrong, getting in front of him,
yes,
moving straight back, moving straight in, not getting the angles that he needs to get. He can get away with that against some fighters, but not a guy with this kind of quality, and a guy that can fight and box as well as Vorapin did, and is equally as tough as Danny Romero was Vorapin tonight.
It's bad enough fighting a southpaw, but when you fight a southpaw that can fight and that's smart, you got a lot of trouble on your hand.
And we mentioned during the course of the fight that Danny has had tremendous success against southpaws. He was 11-0 prior to tonight. I think that's going to move to 11-1 unless something really strange happens on the judges' scorecard. Again, I've got a 98-92 in favor of Vorapin, but my score doesn't count. It's only an indication. Vorapin told me he was dedicating this fight to the king of Thailand, King Bhumibol Adulyadej. And King Adulyadej was actually born in the United States, as the King of Thailand's father attended Harvard University outside of Boston in Cambridge, Massachusetts. And he was born, and he's very, very loved in Thailand. And so Let's get the decision and make it official.
Gentlemen, after 10 rounds of action, we go to the scorecard as we have a majority decision. Here are the score totals. Judge at ringside, Sid Rubenstein, scores the bout 95-95, even a draw. Overruled by judges, Julie Letterman scores the bout 96-94. Ron McNair scores about 97-94 in favor of the winner, Ratanachai Borapi.
Very good fight there. I feel that Borapin won the fight going away hands down. I believe that after Danny Romero got cut, he stopped fighting and he was just looking for the one shot, and Borapin just really outboxed him.